It's time for another Data Science in Australia Q&A. It's been a whole year since I did the last one, so we were long overdue. Today, I'm gonna answer your hottest questions that I've gathered from the comment section as well as Instagram. So if you missed submitting any questions this time, be sure to follow me on my Instagram for the next Q&A. I'm Samanvay, a data scientist living in Sydney, Australia. So the first question is, what made you want to get into data science, or why data science? I initially did an aerospace engineering degree and pivoted into data science as my first graduate role. So there were really three key reasons why I switched into data science. The first was that in data science, as it was mainly software based, you could create and build data products very, very quickly that would have a large amount of impact. Now, this was very different to aerospace, which is a very cyclic industry, which has an extremely long feedback loop. And that basically means that because you're dealing with hardware, you can't just create something extremely quickly, break it, and improve upon it in a very short amount of time. And not to mention that there aren't many jobs like that where you actually get to create new things from scratch on a daily basis. Now, the second reason was the ability to have an impact into multiple industries. Because data science is used in almost every industry you can imagine, you get to work on a variety of problems. The third was really to learn software skills that I could one day use to create my own startup. Because coding is something I always enjoyed throughout my university career. So it wasn't completely out of the blue that I wanted to go into software. And of course, if you want to know more about my transition from aerospace engineering to data science, then be sure to check out my aerospace to data science video. So the next question is, what is your favorite thing about data science? Now for me, this has to be the range of ambiguous problems you have to solve. Because you are dealing with data, there's an infinite number of problems you could really solve with it in any given industry, which really means that you're never bored on the job. Now, across my 6 years as a data scientist, I've worked across a variety of data sets, from finance to aerial imagery to retail. The number of industries you can do data science is ultimately limitless. And that to me is extremely exciting. Next question is a twofold question. So what is the scope of data science in Australia? And what is the type of degree you should do for your master's to get into it? The scope of data science in Australia is huge. After the end of COVID, Australia has opened the floodgate to international students and migrant skilled workers. The quotes for PR has drastically increased by over 35,000 this year alone. The tech industry in Australia is heavily reliant on migrant workers. So there's definitely enough data science opportunities to go around. As for what is the best master's degree to do data science in Australia, it would definitely have to be a Master of Data Science or a Master of Computer Science. Now, if you're definitely more coding and software inclined, I would suggest you to do the Master of Computer Science, because that keeps your doors open to other forms of software engineering, such as front-end development or back-end development, in addition to data science. So you always want to preserve the amount of optionality you have early on in your career. The next question is closely related, which is, does your course have to be ACS accredited for you to get a job after? So ACS stands for Australian Computer Society. And a lot of software courses in Australia tend to be accredited by ACS. It's often the case that a lot of the Master of Data Science or Bachelors of Data Science degrees are not yet accredited by ACS. And it doesn't really matter, because most employers aren't really looking at the ACS accreditation when they look at your CV. At the end of the day, they only care about your education and your competencies, as well as your work experience. And those are the things that really matter, rather than a degree is accredited by some organization like ACS. The next question is, what is the job prospects for graduates after doing a Master of Data Science? In summary, getting a job as an international student in Australia is difficult. There's definitely no two ways about it, but it's not impossible. And a lot of times it relies on your ability to successfully network to get your foot in the door. And I've previously made a video exactly about this topic, showing you the different avenues to practice your networking skills to get internships as well as a job later on. And to add to this, I know quite a few graduates of Master of Data Science that have eventually found jobs. And the thing that's common between all of those is their previous work experience, their internships during their degree, and their interest in doing networking events. And if you're interested in a personalized approach to learning networking, then feel free to sign up for one of my coaching sessions, where I like to personalize a lot of the advice I give to you so it is the most impactful for your individual situation. How do you choose a university to study data science at in 2023? So a lot of the advice here is no different to what I covered in my Master of Data Science video, as well as the Bachelor of Data Science video. So I'll leave the links in the description below so that you can go ahead and look at those. And I'll also share the Notion table that I built with the catalog of all the available data science degrees in Australia. And also let me know in the comments whether or not you want me to do another take of the best universities to do data science in 2023. So the next questions are all related to immigration around PR pathways, as well as what to do given that the data scientist profession is not in the skilled occupations list. So let me address that one first, which is data science profession not being listed on the migration list. So one of the requirements to go down the PR pathway is being on the skilled occupations list. So data scientists, while it's not explicitly on there, there are two professions on there, such as the analyst programmer and the ICT business analyst, where a lot of the responsibilities in those two roles overlap greatly with that of a data scientist. Well, one requirement of the PR application is that your job can be closely related to some of these other professions. So once you start your PR application process, you would go to accredit your skills by the Australian Computer Society, which will determine how close your degree and skills are to these skilled occupations list professions. And I've linked a blog post below which will go through the PR pathway process in a little bit more detail. What are your thoughts on the impact of ChatGPT in schools? In my opinion, students should be allowed to use it. It's just that the education system is going to change very rapidly to accommodate for ChatGPT. Schools are going to need to move from a content-based education system to that which fosters creative and critical thinking. Teachers will now have to teach students how to critically think when it comes to dealing with responses from ChatGPT. And one of the most exciting things about ChatGPT in a learning environment and a school environment is the expected increase in personalized learning. Now teachers will be able to curate personalized learning plans for each of their students. And not to mention that ChatGPT will also alleviate a lot of the admin tasks that is currently done by teachers. Now for one of the hottest questions, which is, will ChatGPT take over the jobs of data scientists or data analysts? So if you follow my channel, you'll notice that my last video was exactly on this topic. And as I mentioned in the video, there'll be less of a need for data scientists to be working on models day in, day out, given that GPT is ushering in a new wave of AI as a service products. So data scientists, for example, will be more responsible for trying to figure out exactly what mathematical or statistical or algorithmic approach to take when it comes to solving a data problem. And as for data analysts, they'll still be doing a lot of the rudimentary work of extracting insights from data. But obviously they can leverage ChatGPT to their advantage to be able to get to these insights quicker. But they still will be responsible for creating the context around which these insights are to be used and making business suggestions off the back of this. So the role of a data analyst will move beyond that of someone that analyzes data to also someone that suggests a lot of business operational improvements off the back of those insights. Next question is, do you use ChatGPT on a day-to-day basis in a work context? Whenever I'm writing code, I prefer to go to Google rather than ask ChatGPT, because more often than not, I'm trying to search for answers for very peculiar code problems. And often if I ask ChatGPT for something like this, I end up cleaning up that code or rewriting it all over again. And if you're using ChatGPT for a lot of these programming use cases for work, I would highly encourage you to be very careful. And you really never know when you might go from asking ChatGPT about code-related questions to feeding it proprietary information, because it can be very easy to accidentally make that mistake. Now, the final question is probably the hottest one for this Q&A, which is, what is the expected average graduate salary for a data scientist after doing their master's degree? I would say it's around 105K, including super. So in Australia, we usually have two components to the salary. One is the base component, and then there's the super component. And the super is usually 10.5% on top of your base salary. Some companies also have bonuses or equity structures that are added to the base plus super components. So 105K is definitely a lot higher as a starting salary than before COVID times. And the reason for this increase is definitely how hot the market is, in addition to the cost of living increases and inflation increases over the last couple of months. So that's all for this Q&A session. If you enjoyed the video, then smash that like button, and I'll see you next time.